Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at Christ, God's tabernacle. Christ, God's tabernacle. Christ as God's tabernacle. Basically, we've said in other video lessons that Christ is the reality of all the shadows in the Old Testament. He was in the Old Testament. He is in the Old Testament, but he was only there in types, in shadows, and prefigures. And we're looking at one of those critical shadow, well, I call it foreshadowed him in the Old Testament. That is the tabernacle. The offerings were pointing to him. The prophets were pointing to him as a reality. The tabernacle as well. So maybe we get into it, what the tabernacle is. I'm not sure we ever came across that word tabernacle in Genesis. I think the first time, I could be corrected, but I think the first time it was used was in the book of Exodus, when God's people had left, God had delivered them from the land of bondage, and he was taking them to the promised land. And in the wilderness, while they were in the wilderness, and there had to be a temporary place of abode, you call it, or a meeting point between divinity and humanity. And God gave the specification for this in Exodus. So the tabernacle is basically God's dwelling place on the earth, God's habitation among men. Prior, when the tabernacle was constructed, of course, in the Old Testament, we had God, like in Garden of Eden, God would come down in the cool of the day to meet with Adam and Eve, also with Abraham, having different encounters with God. But I'm not really sure that there was ever any time or period where God was living on the earth, or a place where you could call a tabernacle, until we get into the book of Exodus. And people had encounters with God in Genesis, don't get me wrong, but it wasn't, God was speaking from heaven and God would come down. It wasn't at a place of abode. So the tabernacle was set up, and God gave the instruction for how the dimensions, the different settings that will be in there. So it's God's dwelling place on earth, it's God's habitation among men, which is very mysterious, because God was no longer just staying in heaven. That's what the connotation of what the tabernacle means, that no longer is Israel, the covenant people of God, having a God speaking to them from heaven alone, or a God that just lives in heaven. But now God is now dwelling among his people on the earth here. But that was a type, that was a shadow. The reality is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the tabernacle brings God to the earth. So we use the expression that that's what actually brought God to the earth here, that a place was built for him. And God is everywhere, no doubt, but he doesn't manifest himself everywhere. So he gave his people the instruction that, so the tabernacle was a means whereby God said, okay, construct this temporary structure, and in it, of course, we get into it in a few pages, where we had the holiest of all, the holy place, and the outer court. So it's a meeting place of divinity and humanity, because God wants to relate with his covenant people. And the people, of course, they needed to know the mind of God. They needed to have a place of abode where they can say that they have a contact point where the spiritual and the physical come in contact, the divinity and the humanity, the invisible and the visible. So the tabernacle seek to serve that purpose, I think, in the mind of God. So through the tabernacle, God was no longer a distance God per se. In reality, they didn't have the full experience we have in the New Testament, but at least God was no longer a distant God as just in the heavens, and whereby they couldn't contact him. So God, of course, gave the instruction for the tabernacle so that it could become contactable, reachable, enterable, and dwellable. So because what the tabernacle did was, we are visual, human beings are visual, we our faith increases to, and that God uses a lot of things, that, for example, the sacraments in the Bible, like the Holy Communion, the anointing, or it's not like God could not really carry out his work or the things he's using those sacraments to do without those things. But because we are human beings and we relate with things we can see, and so God gave the tabernacle, the construction instruction for the tabernacle, so that he could be contact. It's not, the people were not meeting with him physically, but there was a medium where they could see, there was a place where they could have their faith could come up and say that, you know what, we are going to the house of the Lord, we are going to worship God, we are taking our sacrifices of offerings there. And so God became contactable, God became reachable. It doesn't really mean physically, but at least some kind of a temporary measure, enterable and dwellable. Of course, when the Lord Jesus Christ came in John 1:14, that of that the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. That was the physical, that was God himself now appearing, whereby they could relate with him, they could talk with him. But in the Old Testament, it was only there in types and shadows and prefigure. So the thought of God mingling with man is seen in the tabernacle. So you can put it in this way, that God's intention of making divinity and humanity to be blended as one, we could see it in the tabernacle, because the tabernacle was made of, we want to call it, the acacia wood and overlaid with gold, which we could say humanity and divinity. So God was bringing something to the forefront of the Israelites, that look, a day is coming, an age or a dispensation is coming, where this will be the reality, where humanity and divinity can be blended as one. But for now, here is a shadow of what my intention will ultimately be. So in the Old Testament, it was pretty much a physical structure. When the Lord Jesus Christ came in the four gospel, it is the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's eventually going to consummate in the new Jerusalem, Revelation 21, Revelation 22. So let's stay in Exodus for now. The tabernacle instituted in Exodus typified Christ's divinity that is mingled with humanity. So Christ is typified all through the Old Testament. We've done this different video teaching before, the prefiguration of Christ in the Old Testament, where we looked at a lot of the types and shadows and prefigures of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that would be a good resource to at least, we don't want to go into the details, but we're only narrowing the scope into the tabernacle. So it's the reality of all the offerings, the feast, and even the tabernacle. We have also another video on Christ as our offering to God. All the offerings, there were five main ones anyway, and so all of them were pointing to Christ: the burnt offering, the meal offering, the peace offering, the sin offering, the trespass offering. Those are the five key offerings. Every other one comes under those five big categories, and where we looked at each of them, that they were all pointing to Christ, a big chunk of them from the book of Leviticus, and also the feast as well. We, by the grace of God, very soon we will release that. That's Christ as a reality of the seven feasts, the different feasts. The feasts were celebrations, will I call it events, we might call it in our day and age, critical events whereby God, or a ceremony, I think that probably might be a better word to use, like the Passover, the unleavened bread, the first fruits, the Pentecost, the feast of expiation or atonement, the feast of tabernacles. I mean, there were seven of them, and all of them were pointing to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Some of them were like the Passover was just to celebrate the Israel, the Lord's deliverance of the firstborn of Israel when the death angel went through Egypt, the Passover lamb. So they celebrate that every year, of course, which we do in our Eucharist, that's the Holy Communion. So it's the reality of all the offerings, the feast, and even the tabernacle, which is what we are looking at today. So Christ as tabernacle brings God to man. So as the tabernacle, it brings God to man. That is like it makes man have the golden opportunity to relate with his God. So, and Christ as offering is a two-way traffic. You want to say, man needs to meet with God, and God needs to meet with man. So Christ brings God to us in the place of the tabernacle, and Christ also takes us back to God, which is our offering to God. So is the acceptable offering to God, and is the acceptable tabernacle from God. So it comes from God with God to us in the tabernacle, in the place of the tabernacle, the reality of the tabernacle. And of course, in coming back, the other part of that traffic is that he's now taking us back to God with himself, because he's the only acceptable offering to God. Of course, the old Testament sacrifices, he ended all those on the cross of Calvary. So he is the reality of the tabernacle, and it's also the reality of the offerings as well. What a joy. Also, Christ comes with God to us as tabernacle. So he's not just coming alone. There's a mystery of the divine Trinity. There are three that bear records in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. So he's not coming. He said, I and the Father are one. I mean, the Father, and the Father is in me. So he's not just coming to us as tabernacle. He's also coming with the Father. And also, when he's going back to the Father, he's not just going alone. We are now going with him as well. So he comes with God to us, and he goes as tabernacle, and we go with him back to God as our offering before God, the sweet smelling aroma. So Christ goes with us to God as offering. wonderful two-way traffic. So the tabernacle is a portable temple. Someone might want to know, well, what's the difference between the tabernacle and the temple? Basically, the tabernacle was in Exodus as well. It's referred to as the tent of meeting, or in some translation, the presence of the Lord. It's a temporary structure which God, because they were in the wilderness was not their promised land, and of course, as they were sojourning, and these were temporary structures which were put in place so that there will be a meeting point between divinity and humanity. Of course, when Israel got to Canaan land, the promised land, a temple was now built, which was a fixed structure, whereby, of course, the normal building, this was not just tents around that they were moving across. So that's the basic difference between the two. The tabernacle is a portable temple, a temporary dwelling place of God with Israel and the wilderness. I'm not going to the details of the dimensions. The dimensions were, of course, more with the temple, I believe, but that's not the real focus. But the focus is that the tabernacles were temporary, the movable tents, you want to call it, because as Israel was sojourning, while the temple is, of course, like a building we have in our day and age, where you just build a physical structure. So the temple is more of a permanent building or a fixed structure of the tabernacle when Israel got to Canaan land. Also, as the true tabernacle, Christ is the means by which God is joined to man. So it's the very means by which God is joined to man. God's intention has always been to be one with his created man. That's why he made us in his image and his likeness from Genesis 1, because he knew one day he was coming to live in man. He wanted man to live in him, and he also wanted to live in man, a mutual abode. So his intention is to make himself the dwelling place of man. So of course, when Israel went into bondage, in the land of bondage, God's goal, if we take a look at the book of Exodus is not really, yes, Exodus pretty much means exit, but it wasn't just about Israel being delivered from Egypt. That was probably, there are 40 chapters in Exodus, and the first 25 or 24 chapters deals with that. They were delivered from Egypt, they got into the wilderness, and God provided for them a lot of things that were happening. Of course, a pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. And the moment we cross over to Exodus 25, God started giving instruction about how the tabernacle was going to be constructed. So God's goal was not just to deliver them from Egypt, but God's goal, Egypt is a type of the world, the kingdom of darkness, just like we as well. God's goal is not just to bring us out of Egypt, out of the kingdom of darkness, but God's goal was also to make them his dwelling place. That's the picture. That was a picture in the Old Testament. We are in the reality of it. So God's goal is not for you and I in the New Testament. It's not just for us to be delivered from the kingdom of darkness, from the world, from the satanic world, but for us to also be the dwelling place of God. God has said in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 1 or 2, I can read that. Isaiah 66, he said, thus saith the Lord, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build for me, and where is the place of my rest? For all those things my hand has made, and all those things exist, says the Lord. But on this one will I look, on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit, who trembles at my word. So that was a rhetoric question God was asking, that which house are you going to build for me? And of course, the reality, we get into the New Testament and we now understand more of what God's intention was in saying those things, because we now became the house of God in the New Testament because of Christ. Our union with Christ, who is the temple of God, now makes us the temple of God. That's why we go through 1 Corinthians 6, 1 Corinthians 3 as well, that you are the temple of God. The reason why we are the temple of God is because we're in union with Christ, and of course, God is dwelling in Christ. So this makes us the dwelling place of Christ, the dwelling place of God, the divine Trinity. So the tabernacle was built essentially with acacia wood. This was in the Old Testament, overlaid with gold. Strict instruction from God. Exodus 25, 26, Exodus 40. And wood signifies the humanity. We believe that those were everything God is giving in the Old Testament, in the Bible, has there's a reason why. So God gave the acacia wood overlaid with gold. The wood, we believe, signifies humanity, and the gold signifies divinity. And so God was trying to bring a picture that, look, humanity and divinity comes together, blended together as one in the construction of the tabernacle. But that was a physical structure. God's goal is, like, when we get to the New Testament, this is not just going to be a physical structure. This is the reality is not going to be my children, mortal human beings who are now a blend of divinity and humanity, because that's what we are as saints of God. We are not just human. We are not just natural beings like every other human being, because we are saints of God who have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. Our faith in Christ Jesus has now made us the blend of divinity and humanity matched as one. So it's not only the reality of the tabernacle itself, but also the reality of the key content in the tabernacle. So the tabernacle itself is the reality of it. But of course, in the tabernacle there were also some things that were in there. But six critical ones, of course, you have in the holiest of holy place, you have the Ark of the Testimony, you have the table of showbread, you also have the incense altar, you also have the lampstand, and the lampstand and the lights as well, and obviously, so these were things, all of them were pointing actually to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the reality of them. So it's the reality of the tabernacle and the content. So we can go through some of the content that were in it. So first of all, it's the reality of the Ark of the Testimony. So on my Ark, the testimony is basically the law of God, that is the word of God. And the Ark of the testimony is where the ark is, where the testimony is kept. In our modern day and age, we call it safe, you know, like a place where you keep treasures or things that are precious and you lock them up. So the ark was the Ark of Testimony, because the testimony, that the law of God, that is the instruction, what God had given to Moses, or what we can call the word of God, was kept in that ark. So it became what is called the Ark of Testimony. So that's what actually makes it the Ark of the Testimony, because the testimony is inside it, the word of God is inside it, the law of God is inside of it. And we could take a lesson from that. So for us as well as believers in Christ Jesus in this New Testament age, that we have the tabernacle of God, the temple of God, and what makes us the tabernacle and the temple of God is because of the word of God that is abiding in our hearts. That's what distinguishes that ark from any other ark in Israel, because the testimony of God was in it. God's goal is not to have that testimony, which is the testimony of God, the law of God, the word of God, in the ark. God's goal is not to lock it in an ark, but the ark God was referring to, I believe, is the human heart. That was the target of God, but that could not be done then because Christ had not paid the price. Also, the mercy seat upon the ark, which is upon the ark, the showbread on the table. Christ is the reality of the showbread as well on the table. Of course, he said in John 6, I am the bread of life, the bread that comes down from heaven. The showbread was what the priest would partake of, and which they had the right to eat for strength and so that they can minister to God. Of course, the reality of that is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the lamb, the living bread. Also, the lampstand and its lamp is the light of the world, is the light of the new creation, the old creation, the lampstand, which of course we get to Revelation chapter 1, and this became clearer, that the lampstands were the churches, and of course the lamp is the light. So the lampstand being the churches means that the Lord himself is the one that provides the light, because it's the light of the world, and there's no other way you can say that the reality of this is any other thing apart from the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Is the true lampstand, is the true lamp, your word is a lamp unto my feet. And also is the reality of the altar of gold, of the incense. The incense were being burnt, of course, in the altar. It's more like the intercession aspect of the priest's responsibilities. So they burn this incense to intercede. The priests are standing before God on behalf of Israel. So this as well was pointing to Christ as a reality, because he's our intercessor. Hebrews chapter 7, Romans chapter 8 as well, is our great intercessor who is interceding for us until we are saved to the uttermost. The anointing oil as well. I'm not saying that you find the anointing oil in the holy place, but I just put this last three there, and even the mercy seat, in the sense that this was part in Exodus chapter 40, where God had mentioned that, of course, the anointing oil was supposed, all the vessels of the ministry were supposed to be anointed. The anointing oil was to make them hallowed and separated unto God. Of course, Christ, the meaning Christ means the anointed one. Is the reality of that as well. These were types, they are different aspects of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's on this side of eternity we will still not be able to understand everything about him, but of course he desires that we grow in that knowledge. The reality of the anointing oil is the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. The reality of the water for washing, because the priests had to wash their hands and their legs in getting into the tabernacle. Of course, we get to Ephesians chapter 5. He's washing his church by the water of his word. Also, the holy garments that the priest had to put on. The reality, of course, is still the Lord Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 3, among other scriptures, mentioning that put on Christ. As you have been baptized into Christ, so you put him on. It's the garments of righteousness that we are wearing. So you can see, and of course, there are probably a lot of more other types and shadows, but the key ones I wanted to bring out is that the tabernacle itself is pointing to Christ. The content in it, the elements inside of it, and other parts are also pointing to Christ. And here's something I saw from Google Image. It might not be so conspicuous, but basically just a graphic image of what the tabernacle pretty much looks like. It's a very secret thing. You rarely find anywhere where the content and the picture inside will be shown. Even in Hebrews chapter 9, I believe Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. He was even careful to define the things that were in there, because they are not things that mortal man can have words to utter to it. Reading ahead as well. So in the tabernacle, divinity is joined to humanity. Divinity becomes one with humanity, because of course the Ark of the Testimony, where it's the tabernacle being made with acacia, with wood and gold. So the blend is in there, that God was saying that divinity and humanity will become one. The reality of it, humanity is overlaid with divinity. That is, the crown of humanity is now with divinity because of the gold that is on the acacia wood. Also, God is mingled with humanity, which is the eternal plan and eternal goal of God, to be one with his created man, that is humans, his children, the believers in Christ Jesus. And the tabernacle was a picture pointing that will one day come into being, which is what we now enjoy because of what Christ has done on the cross of Calvary. So this very God will do us in unapproachable light, manifested in the flesh, to make himself enterable and a dwelling place for man. So God dwells in unapproachable light. No one can see God and still live. But God, knowing fully well that he created man so that man will make him his dwelling place, and he as well will make man his dwelling place, a mutual abode. So through the tabernacle, God has made himself entryable or dwellable. And the God that dwells in unapproachable light has now condescended himself, God manifests in the flesh, and now made himself in a way whereby man could live in him. That's why today when the expression in the New Testament is used, that we are in him, we are in Christ, we are through him, those are just telling us the picture that we are dwelling in Christ. He even said it several places, especially in John, that abide in me and I in you. I and the Father will make my home in those who keep his word. So we are not just living in the physical world, but we are dwelling in God. We are abiding in God. 1 John also chapter 4 also say, whoever confesses Jesus the Son of God, God abides in him and he abides in God. So we become a mutual abode. So the God that dwells in unapproachable light has made himself entryable, dwellable, reachable to us, especially for us in the New Testament. Christ as God's tabernacle entails two elements, which we mentioned before: God and man, divinity and humanity. The Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. So he's the Son of God and also the Son of Man. Son of God is his divinity, Son of Man is humanity. He is the blend, or we call it the first being, God man, the first God, let me put it that way, because he's God manifest in the flesh, whereby we see a being and externally is human, but internally it is totally divine. That is God himself, God's goal was that the God man creation or the race of Christ is not just going to deadhead in him. His goal, like he mentioned in John 12:24, except the grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abides by itself, but if it dies, it produces much fruit. His goal was to now make, to duplicate himself, to reproduce himself. I think that's a better word I'll use, and which is what we are enjoying today, because now he's not the only God man that ever lived, but we are now God men. That is the blend of divinity and humanity. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us. So the tabernacle was a type of Christ, a mutual dwelling of for both God and man, a mutual dwelling. Do I need to live in God? Do you need to live in God? Yes. I don't think there's any other security anywhere. Say the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. Psalm 91 also says it, that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. The house of God is just God himself. The dwelling place of God is God himself. So God has made himself dwellable, and there's a mutual dwelling between God and man through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a joy, because God is dwelling in Christ. It is impossible for us to go to the heavens to meet God. I don't think there's any airline that space shuttle that will ever be able to get to heaven. It's impossible. Physically, we can't, humanly speaking. But God came down to the tabernacle among us in the person of Jesus Christ. He knew we couldn't come to him. It was utterly impossible for us to go to heaven to meet with God. But God manifested in the flesh. That's why John 1:14 says that, and the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us, and we beheld his glory, full of grace and truth. So God has now made himself reachable to us, and what a joy that the heart of man is now the dwelling place of God. So, and the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us, or dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. So he is the reality. So his coming was now to now end the ministry of the physical tabernacle that Israel had. That's why when he paid the price on the cross of Calvary, we have to understand the four Gospels were a transitionary period between the old and the new. Technically, I could say that, or we could say that the New Testament started from the book of Acts and the outpouring of the Spirit of God, because the new creation started from there. So we can say that in the four Gospels, he was coming as a tabernacle of God, but it was when he paid the price on the cross of Calvary, the veil in the temple was torn apart. And in the eyes of God, in my own understanding, God was no longer just in the holiest of all. The holiest of all, where the Ark of Testimony was no longer the authentic holiest of all. Now God has moved into our heart. Our heart is now the holiest of, it's now the dwelling place of God. That's why Ephesians 3 talks about that Christ may make his home in our heart, that we are the temple of God. So prior to his crucifixion, he was unenterable. We couldn't stay in him. But upon his resurrection, the way was paid for us to enter into him. And in John chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, he said a lot of mysterious and profound things. And prior to that period, we could not enter into him. Man could not live inside of him. It was impossible. I mean, a mortal human being cannot live inside another mortal human being. But he was going to the cross. He said that, look, that day is coming whereby where I am, that you may be also, in John chapter 14, which we also read as well. He said that he, and his prayer to the Father in John 17 was that where I am, I want them to be there as well. He was in the Father. He is in the Father. And his goal was to get us inside him. That's why I said that day, you will know that I am in the Father, you are in me, and I in you. What a joy for what he has done. So he needed to go through crucifixion and resurrect before he could bring us into himself. Very mysterious transaction. So in my Father's house are many abodes, many mansions, or in some translation, but that is many dwelling places. So I am coming again and will receive you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Where I am, you may be also. John 14:2-3. So his goal was to get us to where he was, that he wanted us to, invariably was saying that, look, I have to go and die on the cross, resurrect, before I can bring you into myself. Very mysterious. So today, that's why we are in Christ. We are in Christ and Christ is in us. Hallelujah for what the Lord has done for us. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. Money cannot buy this great thing the Lord has done for us. That yes, we could see ourselves as just walking on the surface of the earth, but we are not walking alone. We are never alone. In him we live, we move, and have our being. We are in Christ. We are in union with him. It is of God that you are in Christ Jesus. So we are in Christ Jesus. Christ is our dwelling place. Christ is our abode. And we are the abode of Christ as well, because we are his house, we are his temple. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy for what the Lord has done. So for it pleased the Father, this Colossians 1:19, it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. So all the fullness of God dwells in Christ. And Colossians 2:9 as well, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. He is the embodiment of God. He is the embodiment of the Godhead. He's not just representative of the Godhead. Representative is like, okay, someone is representing a higher authority. He is the embodiment. God, you will not, in the New Testament, you will not find God outside of Christ. the God we serve in the Christendom is dwelling in Christ. And that's why God has also brought us into Christ as well, because He is the temple of God, is the tabernacle of God. So you will not find God outside of Christ, because He and the Father, they are one. What a joy, what a joy. Hallelujah. The tabernacle which was once outward and visible is now inward and invisible in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ in our heart. So we have the physical tabernacle. It does not mean, I'm not discounting the fact that we have churches now. Someone will say, oh, but we have churches today. But really, what makes a church is just because of the saints of God that are dwelling there. It's the saint. A church could change their address. It doesn't mean that that's them. If they move to a better, to maybe to a bigger location, and all of a sudden a company comes and start baking bread there, it doesn't mean that brick and mortar is the dwelling place of God. What makes this church, the brick and mortar, the dwelling place of God, is because the saints of God are there. So we are now, because our heart is now the holiest, there's the holiest of all in heaven, and our heart is deeply, connected there because of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, basically. Because Christ is in our heart, and at the same time is in heaven, and that's what makes our heart the dwelling place of God. So it's no longer outward and visible per se, but now it is inward and invisible in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the temple of God. So if we love one another, God, 1 John chapter 4, if we love one another, God abides in us. By this we know that we abide in Him and He in us, because He has given us of His Spirit. So we can see the dwelling. And John wrote a lot in his gospel, in his epistle. He did write a lot about the union between divinity and humanity. That is, we, the saints of God, and the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the relationship we have with the Trinity. So whereby if we love one another, God abides in us. That is God was abiding in the tabernacle, but that was a shadow. We are the reality as well. And what a joy. And He does this by His Spirit. Also, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him. God abides in him, and he in God. We confess that the Lord is the Son of God, is born of God, and God says that how hard is it to confess that Jesus is the Son of God as a believer? Very easy. And God said, oh, once you can confess that, then I abide in you and you abide in me. But it just pushes us to a place of adoration and praise and thanksgiving to God. I mean, He has so made it so, it's unbelievable to think in a human, speaking humanly speaking, or speaking in a normal human, that God, I am the dwelling place of God, I am the tabernacle, you are the tabernacle of God, the temple of God, the dwelling place of God, the house of God, that this mighty God. Imagine, for example, I tell you that, oh, in my house, you could park your private airplane, or even a space shuttle could be parked in my garage or in your garage. In the back of your mind, that, wow, how huge and big is that garage or that house of yours, if a whole space shuttle or an airplane could park in there. Now imagine that the Most High God is dwelling in my heart and in your heart. Imagine how huge, if that's even an understatement, of what our spirit being is, our spirit man, our heart is. It can contain God. It contains God. Wow. I think we have two sets of hearts. There's a physical one, and there's also the spiritual one. Those ones, you will not see it in an x-ray. That one is, says that the eyes of our hearts be enlightened. So our hearts, our spirit man has his own side, and God is dwelling in there. That is huge. That is huge. That is huge. That's why the enemy fights having us feed on the Word of God, because the more we feed on the Word of God, the more we are able to experience more of the presence of God in our life, because the Word of God is God Himself, John 1:1. So, and that's what makes us the tabernacle and the temple of God, because the Word of God is in our heart, similar to the ark of testimony. What makes that ark different from every other ark is because the testimony, the Word of God, is inside that ark, and God was actually giving us a picture. That's why I said, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly. What a joy. So, and I heard a great voice, Revelation 21, out of heaven, saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. Also, but Christ has a son over His own house, whose house we have, Hebrews chapter 3:6. And the joy of this is, like, we are the house of God. We are the believers, because God is dwelling in our hearts. God is dwelling in our hearts. And so if someone were to ask God, what is his physical address on the earth? He's going to point to me. He's going to point to you, every one of us that are believers in Christ Jesus. That's why I try. If you want to find me, please, I'm in one of my believers. I'm living in every one of them. God has to just open our eyes to this mystery so that we can grow in it. What a joy in it. Also, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. This Ephesians chapter 3 verse 16-17, that he will be strengthened with might in our inner man, that Christ will make his home in our hearts by faith. What a joy that he's living in our heart, is dwelling in us, and our heart is the temple of God, is the dwelling place of God. Do you not know that you are the temple of God? That you are, we are the temple of God. We are the temple of God because of our union with the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why, I mean, we can't afford to just live a reckless life. We can't afford to just let anything that is toxic fill our heart. Is the word of God said in Romans 8 that to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So we can't afford to just have, and that's why the enemy knows it fully well, that look, let me attack the mind, let me attack the heart, let me attack their spirit being. Once I'm able to make that place disturbed with a lot of needless things, they know they pretty much can't experience what it takes to be the dwelling place of God. And that's why we fight the good fight of faith as well, because the heart is where the seed of the word of God will grow. So here's John chapter 2 as well, that Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up. But he spoke of the temple of his body. So he was actually talking of his temple. He had told them that, look, they were buying and selling in the temple, and he was very, with a holy anger, he was flogging out everyone that was, the money changers away. And they were like, what sign? Show us the sign. They bring down this temple, and in 3 days, he said, what? It took us 46 years or thereabout, and you're going to raise it in 3 days. But he was referring to his body, because his body was going to be destroyed on the cross of Calvary and now resurrected to be the temple of God. So today we've been able to look at Christ as God's tabernacle. We said that the tabernacle is God's dwelling place on earth, that the tabernacle is God's habitation among men. In the Old Testament, God had given the instruction for the construction of this when his people were delivered from the land of bondage from Egypt, and God gave specification. Every one of those things were pointing to Christ. The tabernacle was pointing to Christ. The offering were pointing to Christ. The contents in the tabernacle were pointing to Christ. In the holiest of all, we have the Ark of Testimony. And in the holy place, we have the table of showbread, we have the incense, we have the lampstand as well. And so every one of those things were pointing to Christ as a reality. We also said that Christ came in the New Testament, God manifest in the flesh. So the God that was unapproachable, that dwells in unapproachable light, now made himself dwellable, entryable for us is believers in Christ Jesus. That's the joy we are experiencing today, that we are not just another physical statistics on the surface of the earth, but we are the dwelling place of God. We are the temple of God, that wherever we go, we are the mobile, we carry the presence of God wherever we go. We also said as well that God became contactable, it became reachable, it became dwellable through the tabernacle that they had given to Israel. That was a type, that was a shadow that was pointing to us in the New Testament in Christ Jesus. And today we can definitely say that, of course, the tabernacle was, we could say there are three levels of the tabernacle. The one God gave in Mount Sinai, which is what was constructed in the book of Exodus. We also have Christ in the gospel, who is the temple of God. And the consummation of this will actually be in the New Jerusalem in Revelation 21-22, the eternal dwelling place of God and man together. What a joy that we have the Lord Jesus Christ. All through the New Testament, we see there that whoever confesses that Jesus is Son of God, God abides in him, and he abides in God, abide in me and I in you. A central theme we could see in the New Testament, God keeps saying that, look, my goal for delivering you out of the kingdom of darkness is not just for you to be delivered, but for me to make you my dwelling place, to dwell in your heart and for you to dwell in me. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ, God's tabernacle. Hallelujah.